Another chance, another opportunity to come and praise Him. Amen. Thank God for giving us an opportunity to praise Him. I'm going to read a scripture for you today, Proverbs 3, verses 5 through 6. Proverbs 3, verses 5 through 6 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not unto your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your path." Let's go to God in prayer. Father God, we thank you. God, we honor you, we praise you. We thank you for another privilege, another honor to come before you. We thank you, God, for who you are, for what you do. Lord, we thank you for 165 days of watching over us. God, nobody could do it but you, and you've done it again. God, we ask you, Father God, to bless us as we come before you tonight, that we will honor you in praise and in worship. Bless our time together, Father God, that we will look to you, that our lives will be made the better, that we will be strengthened by you. As we prepare to go into the next year, we ask you to bless our hearts and hold us. Lord, if you see fit to cross us over, we ask you, Father God, to keep us and keep our focus on you. Lord, bless us in this service tonight. Bless us to stand freely, to walk freely, to glorify you freely, to honor your holy and righteous name. Bless us today, Father God, that as we honor you, that we will hear from heaven, that we will see Jesus, that our lives will be changed and made the better. It's in the precious, powerful, anointed name of Jesus Christ we pray, and we ask it all. Amen. And thank God. Welcome to you to our New Beginning Eve service. We're going to follow the leadership of these musicians as we come to praise the Almighty God.
Bless the Lord with me. We have come to just bless the Lord because we thank God for just allowing us to be here.
Everybody sing.
is why my heart is filled with praise. God first loved us. Amen. It's been very close to 365 days in this year, and God has blessed us one more again. And I'm excited about it. I'm glad that God has left us here just to honor him and praise his name. We serve such an awesome and mighty God. The devotional scripture says, trust in the Lord in all your ways. Lead not into your own understanding. In every way you have, trust in him. And he is faithful enough to direct your path. We serve such an awesome God until he sees far ahead of us before we get there. He knows what we ought to be doing, and he knows what he has prepared for us. In January 1st of 2023, God saw December 31st, 2023, and he knew where we would be on this day. Now, I'm going to open the mic to somebody in the room that wants to tell about God's goodness and what God has already done for you. The senior saints would say like this, he kept us through dangers seen and dangers unseen. The senior saints would say that he forgave us for our sins of omission and sin of commission. The senior saints would say that we serve such a good God until he gave his only begotten son, Jesus, and it gets sweeter and sweeter with him every day. Matter of fact, they would say that it gets sweeter and sweeter round by round and wrong by wrong. Is there anybody in the room that want to come forth today and just share? If you want to share, I'll meet you down here, give you the mic, and tell us just the goodness of God and what he has done this year for you. The testimony of the saints empower other saints. Testimony of God gives us strength and hope for the future. And I just want to serve notice on you tonight. In 2024, we're going to need God. We're going to need hope. We're going to need strength. Because really, you haven't seen anything yet. The Congress is already upside down. The presidency is on the brinks of collapsing. We need to understand that if we're going to trust anybody, we're going to have to trust the Almighty God. Will there be one, two, three, four, five that will spring up and talk about God's goodness? Anybody, just talk about what God has done for you. There's movement.
Next year we will be asking him again. However, it does not stop me from saying that he has been good to me and our family this year. I fell sick, my father fell sick, and here I am healed today, all because the Lord decided to heal me. I didn't have any issues on my job, because my job, like they go up and down with the layoffs and whatnot. I still have my job. Now, I know it sounds like everyday things, but the way I look at it, every day is a blessing because the Lord decided to allow me to see that day. And here it is at the end of the year, and I'm looking forward to, what, the next 4 hours or something like that, to seeing another year in which I hope and I pray that he blesses me and my family. Now, I didn't think I would have a smile on my face on tonight. But it's really all about him. Yes. It's really all about giving him the glory.
Yes,
no matter how small a thing is, no matter what I asked him for this year and didn't get and all that, it doesn't matter. In the end, he still deserves all of the praise, all of the glory. talk about all the politics and all that stuff that you want. Yes. At the end of the day, the Lord has blessed us.
Yes, sir.
I have food on my table. Sounds mundane, doesn't it?
Yeah.
I have food to eat.
Yes, sir.
There's some people, little kids on the street, trying to find something to eat because they are hungry.
Yeah.
And I go back home, I got a fridge and an ice box, all that stuff full of food and sweets. It's all because the Lord has decided to bless me. So even though I didn't get something else that I wanted, the Lord has nonetheless blessed me and my family. And I'm thankful to him for allowing me and my family to be here and to usher in a new year. And we just look forward to him doing even more for us on next year. So I give all the praise, all the glory, all of the thanks to God, because he is the one who has blessed me. He is the one who has kept me.
Yes.
I'm only standing here right now today because the Lord decided to keep me here to the end of this year and prayerfully into the next year. So I thank the Lord and thank you, Pastor, for his time.
Thank you so much. I figure once the ice gets broken, then people will move. Look at God. Look at God. Hallelujah. We serve the awesome and the amazing.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within it. Good evening. I just want to get up with a big old thank you, Lord. From 23 January up until this time, one of the things that I vowed in the beginning of 23 was I was coming to Sunday school. No matter what, I was going to get up and get here for 9 o'clock. I missed a few, maybe if I was out of town. But if I was in town, I was to Sunday school. And I just want to thank God for that. That was a commitment that I said that I was going to do. And by me coming, I was bringing my grandchildren. See, it's not just about me. I'm trying to get my grandchildren to be able to go out in this cruel world and be able to stand against the wild. And sometimes they drag me down. But as long as I got breath in my body, you coming with me. Tonight they said, all they had been saying, they wasn't coming tonight. I said, but everybody is going to leave this house. We're going to lock this house tonight. So all them who didn't want to come, they back here now. They are here. But I just want to thank God I got a good mammogram, all my test came out good this year. It's just a blessing. My husband retired and we on the fixed income, but God met every need. We no bill is lacking. Food in the box, food on the table. I had all 7 of my grandchildren today. I done fed them from the time I went home until they just left. I tell you, they all came in and they all were saying, Granny, we want, we want. I had some leftovers, but I had to pull out the pot and cook again. They still didn't have enough. So my son and them, they took them home. So I just thank God for my grandchildren. I thank God for my family. I thank God for my husband, somebody that stands with me no matter what. And everything we go to do, we can put our heads together and stand together. Because the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But God said, I came that you may have life and have it in abundance. And so my grandchildren know I quote that scripture when they're going to school. Stay focused. The enemy is out there for y'all. So you have to stay focused. So I just want to say, Lord, I thank you. I thank you, Lord, for this year. And if you allow me to see it next year, I'll do better than I did in 23.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Who's coming? Who's coming? There's movement. Who's coming? There's movement. There's another piece of movement. Amen.
Good evening, everyone, and happy New Year's Eve. 2021 is when my life flipped, and I flipped. I had a major wreck. Broke my back. I'm still trying to come to church. I've had 3 surgeries. I was on a cane. I was on a walker. Now I can do it like that. I did. So now I can take those 15 steps and go down those 15 steps and don't worry about anything. I ask God to give me strength daily to grow closer to Him.
Hallelujah. Have another one coming. Hallelujah. Good evening, everyone. I have a lot to be thankful for. I really do. I look around and I see so many people struggling and hurting, you know, and he's blessed me. He's taking care of me. It's so good to have an ultimate shepherd, the one that walk it like you talk it. He is my Heavenly Father. He leads and directs my path each and every day. He makes every day a Christmas and every night a new year. And I thank Him for it. I thank Him for my life. I thank Him for my granddaughter, my grandson, and I especially thank Him for my wife, who continues to be the unique manifestation to my cosmetic universe. Thank you so very much, dear Lord. For you, Lord, you are the ultimate one, and I put no other God before thee. Thank you for the days and nights. Thank you for watching over us as we slumber and sleep. Thank you, dear Lord, for touching us and waking us up every morning, because you don't have to do it. But I know you do it because you love us so much. And I am so thankful to have you as my leader. My one who's there for me, whether I need him or not, he's there. He showers me with blessings and abundance each and every day. And I thank him for it. I thank him for my health and strength. I thank him for days to come and days that have passed. For it is only him who is going to carry me through it and deliver me to it. Thank you so very much.
Amen. It's always good to have a rhetorician in the house, a wordsmith. It's always good. Anybody else coming? Who else is coming? Someone else is coming. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Good evening.
Get the slogan for the night. She said he blessed me a whole heap of plenty in 2023, and he getting ready to bless me some more in 2024.
That was my slogan, I swear. Girl, I ain't good. Anyway, all my praises go to Lord. I'm 20 years almost. And I'm 68 years of age, right? And every morning I get up, sometimes I don't want to go, but I always go with my health, my strength. See, I can still do all this stuff. I can do it now because one day I hurt my leg and I couldn't. God has been good to me, and my blessings have been good. I was thinking this morning, I got ready to pay my tithes, and I said, Lord, when it's small, I don't have a problem paying it. But when it's big, I have a problem, and God says, that's not yours. So I encourage all y'all, if God been good to you, pay your tithes. That's one of the things I encourage you about. But I have so much to be grateful for. This has been one of the best years of my life. I've been to the doctor now one time. I have my aches and my pains, but everything is getting better and better. And I always encourage people, when I look around, I have a son who's on drugs, and I struggle, and I was worried about it. God says, his name is on the prayer list, and I've seen him laying in the middle of the road, car go around him. I've seen him fall off the third floor, and he's still living. So those prayers, God answered me. But I am so grateful to God because he's been so, so good. I'm serious. He's good to me. I'm a four-time loser, and I have just as much as my college friends, and I'm one person working, and they have wives and husbands, and I can show more than they have. They are together. God has blessed me. I came home in 06. I haven't looked back. I have friends who call me today to relapse. Relapse. Back on drugs. And I thank God that he kept me. Some people can say they got arrested, but I got rescued when I went to jail. I met my pastor in prison. This is my testimony. I met my pastor in prison. And he used to ask me, I used to see him and say, I got 3 more months, I got 4 more months, I got this. And he says, when I got down to last month, he says, you got 1 more month. And I've been here with him 19 years. He called me at the last minute of the day, the night, he says, and I just came from the job. He says, brother, I need you there at 7:15. I said, man, I'll try to make it. But I don't give up. Just keep going. You get there. You'll get there. This year has been a great year for me. We're almost to the year of 24. And I'm going to tell y'all, every day I get up, I can see we're living in the last days. I can see the signs of times. I can see the construction. I can see the wars. I can see men's love of themselves. I can see it all. And all I can tell you, keep your eyes on the prize, and that's Jesus, because time is near. I hear the pastor say it every Sunday, if you miss me, I'm waiting on the rapture. Because sooner or later, he said, the end is going to come. Yeah. And my end is coming on this mic right now. I'm going to give it back to you, Pastor Davis. Thank you. I love you.
Amen. Hallelujah. Before we get our praise team to come, is there anyone else coming? Is there anyone else? Anyone else coming? Bless the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Good afternoon, everybody, my family. Well, I'm just grateful just to be alive. A couple of years ago, me and my husband was going through some changes, but the Lord is good, y'all. My family and my friends said to leave him, but God didn't tell me to leave him. So I hung on in there with him, and things are wonderful. And I know we're going to have bad days in the future. Just like you have rainy days, you have sunshiny days. So, but I thank God for what a place I'm at, we're at right now. And also, I want to thank the Lord. When I had my major surgery, he brought me through it. I really thought I had really messed up this time, y'all. I said, oh God, told my kids, I said, y'all get ready, I'm going home. They said, well, Mama, I kept throwing up blood. I was going through so much, but the Lord brought me through that as well. And I'm just trying to keep my hand in the master hand. And you guys do the same.
Amen. Who's coming? Who's coming? There's movement. I see your hand move, but what about your feet? Come on, Hayden. Come on, give us a big, great testimony from the youth area tonight. Amen. Ashley used to think she was a youth. Now she doesn't think she's a youth anymore. Hazel, come on, represent. Represent.
Hey, y'all. This year, I went through like a journey with God. I will say that sometimes as a young person, you go through like thinking, well, if God really loved me, why didn't I brought me through. And now I'm on a journey to get my associate's next semester while in high school. And I'm really proud of that. And I know that I couldn't have done it without God.
Hazen gets to graduate with a college degree and a high school degree.
ago, I was a football fan. I would buy season tickets to the football game. On Sundays, I was going to do one of these numbers. And I had to leave out of church because I was going to August. And I did it for many, many years. It's one member, and she's a member of this church. She told me one Sunday, "You need to come to Sunday school." I said, "I ain't going to Sunday school. I don't need to go to Sunday school. I go to church." But she, that's her name, is Diane Henry. And she started me to come to Sunday school. And when she did that, I have not stopped yet. I do whatever I can for the Lord. Last year, my brother was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. On December the 11th, they gave him 6 weeks to 2 months. He died exactly 2 months to the date that he diagnosed him. This has been a hard year. Me and my sisters, no one knows it, but we have been feuding and fighting. We have been not speaking. My mother is 93 years old. I've never in my life want to let her see us argue and fight like we did in front of her. But I ask God to please forgive us. And on my mother's 93rd birthday, I told my sisters, I say, this is the day that we gonna get this to right. So I took my mother to the salon, and we got together. That day we prayed like we never prayed before. And to this day, we have not turned back. We do it for each other. We go. If we have to take care of our mother, we make it out. We work it out. So I'm telling you, if you have siblings, don't fight with them, because you're going to need them. I thank Pastor. I thank Sister Davis. Sister Davis got me into exercising, and I haven't stopped yet. And I just say thank you. My last thing is, in 2021, I decided to retire. And I didn't know. I said, I can't make it on this little bit of money. I can't make it on this little money. I haven't had a light turned on. I have a car, I paid my car off. Don't have no house, no. I pay my tithes. So God is good, and I thank him.
Amen. We got time for two more. We have two more. Got one here, one more. Who's coming?
I give praise and honor to God and just thank God for just being so good to me. Yes, y'all already know my testimony. Some of you all do. And I don't ever want to forget what God has brought me through, because I am a breast cancer survivor. And I thank God because he has given me purpose. I thank God for every single member here at the New Beginning Church. I thank you so much, and I just see God doing a new thing in this church. Amen. Normally, when Pastor Davis come up here and ask for testimonies, he have to go out there and pull people out the audience. But look, you see how good God is, and God has just blessed us tremendously. And I just thank God. I thank God for the children here at the New Beginning Church. These children, they're obedient children. I thank God for the parents who are raising their children in a God-fearing way. So thank you, parents, and thank you for just giving me purpose, because it does my heart joy to teach music to the boys and girls and tell them about Jesus, because that is the reason why God has left me on this earth. And that is to tell the youngsters about Jesus, because that's who they're going to need before they leave this world. So thank you all so much.
Amen. Bless the name of Jesus. We're going to do a few more things before we leave this place. First of all, I want to remind you of our focus. Brother Carter said we're going to pack the pews. And he's right. Our focus for 2024 is to reach 50 souls for Jesus Christ. Not 49 and a half, but reach 50 souls. We're gonna make sure we reach 50 souls for Jesus. I said to this church many times, if we're not gonna walk in faith, if we're not gonna be a praying church, if we're not gonna be a word talk church, if we're not gonna trust God, we might as well shut the doors, put club on the sign outside, and go to hell in style. But in 2024, our focus will be threefold. Number one, prayer. We're going to pray consistently. We're going to pray privately. We're going to pray publicly. We're going to pray for people who don't like us. And we're going to pray for people that we don't like. You may act like you Holy Ghost feel tonight, but there's somebody somewhere that just get under your skin, and Jesus says, pray for your enemies. So we're going to be known at this location as the house of prayer. Secondly, we're going to do evangelism. We're going to reach souls. We're going to minister to people. We're going to evangelize. Jesus says we ought to start in Jerusalem, move to Judea, go to Samaria, and then the utmost parts of the world. So if you don't have a passport, you need one. You need to make sure that we evangelize. The third thing we're going to do is we're going to disciple. Get involved in discipleship. The men have already been challenged to coach younger men. Been challenged to reach somebody. We've been challenged to move in the lives of young people. And we believe that God has equipped us to disciple young men and women unto Christ. And we thank God for it. Our focus, I'm requesting every person to identify five people that you will disciple this coming year. Five people, if they're not saved, you would lead them to Christ. Come on up, Pastor. That second row is reserved for you and your bride. I am looking forward to each person of the New Beginning Church to disciple five people, to lead them to Christ, to lead them to baptism, and lead them to church membership. And when you disciple someone, you stick with them. You don't birth a baby and put them on the front porch and say, go play. When you lead somebody to Christ, you have to walk with them, understand them, and show them the way of Jesus Christ. So this is our goal for 2024. Be a praying church, an evangelistic church, and a discipling church, so we can keep the doors open. Because if we lift up Jesus, he will draw all men unto himself. We serve the awesome and the great God. Pretty simple, pretty simple. Five people that you will disciple, five people that you will evangelize to. Young people are looking for young people their age to evangelize, to pray for them, and to disciple them. I'm glad to have the other two pastors who worship with us here at the New Beginning Church. Our church is multicultural. Our church is Saturday and Sunday, Wednesday and Thursday. And I'm glad that we look like heaven is going to look. We look just like heaven. I mean, John said, I saw a number, 144,000. And he said, wait a minute, let me look again.
And he says, I see a number that no man can count. And that's what heaven ought to be like. A multicultural church. So what we're going to do is we're going to have Pastor Chavez and his wife come and say a good night to us. And then after they have finished, we're going to bring forth an offering. And our offering for tonight will go to Pastor Watson. Pastor Watson will receive the offering that we contribute tonight. And after we do the offering, we're going to have a song. And then we're going to have Pastor Watson come and preach to us tonight. Or say some words to us. After he has done preaching, then we're going to have communion. Break bread. And by then, our sanctified imagination will say 12 noon. 12 midnight, rather. You got to use your sanctified imagination tonight. By the time we take communion, it will be 12 midnight, and we will be rejoicing that God has crossed us over. Yeah. One more time. Pastor Chavez and his wife are coming. Service. See, Pastor Chavez and I get together and we have hoopology together. I'm teaching him how to hoop like a black preacher. He's learning how to hoop. Can you imagine him hooping in Spanish? He does it every Sunday afternoon at 3:30. If you want to come by and visit with him and see the excitement that they bring to this place, come by at 3:30 on Sunday evening. We put together a flyer with all three churches on them, and we publicize those flyers because we believe that every church ought to support a church. And therefore, we're so glad that you have come tonight. It is offering time. It is time to give to the Lord through tithes, offering, and sacrificial gifts. It is time to give to the Lord, and tonight our offering will go to Pastor Brian Watson. Pastor Brian Watson, if you happen to Zelle tonight, note on there, Pastor Brian Watson. If you need an envelope, please raise your hand and you will be served. If you need an envelope, raise your hand and put on that envelope right where it says special, Pastor Brian Watson. Pastor Watson is where our love offering will go to tonight. Amen. Raise your hand real high if you need an envelope. Father God, we thank you for this privilege of giving. We ask you to bless every gift and every giver. In Jesus' name. First impression from the rear to the front and bring forth your offering. Let's decide to stand and come and bring forth your offering.
Blessings and glory and honor, yeah, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing.
God, we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah to the Lamb. It is preaching time. I say it is preaching time. It's preaching time. It is time to hear from the man of God, from the word of God. It is preaching time. Amen. I am so glad that Pastor Brian Watson is churching here at the New Beginning Church. When we finish around 12:15, 12:30, whatever you say it is, he's coming in the door to begin his service at the Gateway Community Church. And he's been a blessing to our church in that when I get stuck out of town, he preaches to the people here at the New Beginning Church. When I have technical difficulties with electronics that he knows about, I call on him and he gets me out of a bind. He's been a real brother, and tonight we call him Pastor Brian Watson. In a few more months, we will be calling him Pastor Dr. Brian Watson. And I'm so glad that he's allowing me to be a part of his dissertation process, and we're looking forward to celebrating with him. Will you stand to your feet one more time and welcome to this sacred desk of authority, our brother, our friend, our companion in the Lord Jesus Christ, Pastor Brian Watson.
Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, put your hands together for Jesus today. Hallelujah. Come on and just slip your hands to the Lord and just sing a little bit of this song. I guess I am going to sing a song. Thank you, Lord. Unconditionally, with no strings attached, and that nothing separates us from your love. Thank you for forgiving us of our sins. Thank you, God, for cleaning us, God. Thank you, God, for straightening us up. Thank you, God, for picking us up out of the miry clay, God, and the below low places, God. God, we thank you, Lord, that you have blessed us in every way. And as we go into this new year, God, give us a word, God, that will reignite our faith, God, that will recharge us, God, that will lift us up, that will empower us, God, that will set us on the path that you want us to be on, God. And we give you the praise and the glory and the honor in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. Come on, put your hands together as you take your seat. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, I am grateful today, this evening, as Pastor Davis has said, he's a brother to me in many ways, just over the years that we've developed a bond, and I'm grateful for his friendship, his brotherhood, as well as Sister Davis. I always like to acknowledge her because, of course, they're one, and you can't have one without the other, and so I'm grateful for them. They are like big brother and big sister to me, and I'm grateful for them. I'm grateful for all of you tonight. And I heard a story once. It was a little boy that was in church with his dad. And as the preacher got up, he said, "I won't be before you long." And the little boy looked over to his dad. He said, "Dad, what does the preacher mean when he say, I won't be before you long?" And his dad said, "Shh." He said, "Not a darn thing, son, not a darn thing. I won't be before you long tonight," all right? But seriously, I don't plan to be before you long. I want to share something with you. It actually goes in. This is part of the Christmas story, the Christmas narrative. But I believe it's something that we can hear and we can use going into this new year. Going into this new year. And so I want you to look, if you have your Bibles, Luke chapter 1. We're going to look at Luke chapter 1. And this is the story of Mary and receiving, when Mary received word that she would give birth to the Son of God. What an honor, what a privilege, what a responsibility to bring forth the Son of God into the world, to be the mother of the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. What a privilege she had, an opportunity. And in this, I believe there are three things that we can learn that in some ways we may need to be reminded of, as I said, as we go into this new year. Three things. And I'm going to give them to you right after I read this scripture in Luke chapter 1, verse 26. And I'm going to read this from the New King James Version of the Bible. So yours may read a little different, but I promise you we'll get to the same point. If you're there, everybody there, say word.
Word.
All right, sound like the majority of people are there. Now, it says here, in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And having come in, the angel said to her, "Rejoice, highly favored one, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women." But when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying and considered what manner of greeting this was. Then the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God." What an awesome statement. "And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. For he will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Verse 34, legitimate question. Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I do not know a man?" I've never been with a man, never been in relations with a man. Angel said to her, verse 35, answered and said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest will overshadow you. Therefore also, that Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. Now indeed, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age, and this is now the sixth month for her who was called barren. For with God, nothing will be impossible." Somebody need to underline that. You need to put it in your phone, text it, write a note. For with God, what? behold, the maidservant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. And the angel departed from her. I wanted to share three things that will help you in this new year to have a prosperous, blessed new year. Three things that you need to do. And I'm going to give them to you up front. And I say this at the risk of losing your attention, because you know how we like to hear, you know, we get to the climactic end of the story. I'm going to give you the three parts at the beginning and hope that you will stick around to hear the rest of how I unpack it. First of all, Mary listened. That's the first thing she did. She listened. The second thing she did was she learned. Third thing that she did, and that we're going to have to do, she leaned. Mary listened, Mary learned, and Mary leaned. I'm a school teacher, so I have to make sure my students got what I'm saying. I want you all to repeat back to me. Mary, what's the first thing Mary did? Listen. The second thing she did?
Learned.
She learned. And the third thing she did was? She leaned. You know, back in the day, they used to say diamond in the back, sun rooftop, digging the scene with it with gangster lean. I didn't even brother know what they're talking about. Then, not long ago, I'm going to bring for the young people, somebody said lean with it, rock with it. And we said, okay, come to church. They say leaning on the everlasting arms. Okay, we're going to have to do some leaning. But she listened, she learned, and she leaned. If we're going to have a successful year, 2024, we're going to have to do three things. What are they? We're going to have to listen, we're going to have to learn, and we're going to have to lean. In our text today, Mary has having her encounter with an angel, with Gabriel. And I love this. Gabriel stands before her, and Gabriel announces that she is going to have a child. Again, a child, not just any child, but the Son of the Most High God. She was going to conceive a child because she found favor. I'm telling you, favor. And favor of the Lord is worth more money than anybody could give you. The favor of God is valuable. In Psalm 5 and 12, it says that he surrounds the righteous with favor as with the shield. So as we go into this new year, thank God for favor. Just thank him. Just say, God, I just thank you for favor. God, I thank you for favor on my job. I thank you, God, for favor with the health people. I thank you for favor with my bills. I thank you for favor. Somebody say, God, I thank you for favor. He said, you have found favor with God. Don't be afraid. There were 450 fear nots in the Bible. I believe God has to address the fear in Mary as she's standing here before an angel. I believe she's probably fearful as any of us would, and so he addresses the fear. One of the things that we're going to have to deal with as we go into this year, we're going to have to deal with our fears. I'm not talking about the obvious fear, like fear of snakes, fear of bats. That's my fear. But I'm talking about fear of success. I'm talking about fear of jumping out into something and doing something maybe that you have never done before. Jumping out into doing what God is leading, you feel God is leading you to do, even though you've never seen it done before or you don't know how you're going to do it. I'm talking about not being afraid to go further than what you've gone before. Don't be afraid. Somebody say, don't be afraid. And as we go into this year, we're thanking God for favor. He says to her that she's going to conceive a child and bring forth a son. Now, this was what we call the Immaculate Conception. It's important for us because it's foundational to what we believe as Christians. Because if it was not for the virgin birth, we could not have a Savior who was sinless. Because remember, sin is passed down from generation to generation. It came from our father Adam in the garden. It's been passed down from generation to generation. So God said, I'm going to have to, in order for me to bring my son into the world, he's going to have to come through the womb of a woman, but he's going to have to be sinless in order to be the perfect sacrifice. And that's going to mean that he can't have an earthly father. And so this conception is so very important. The virgin birth is so very important as believers. We must understand this. She had to conceive And she's wondering, how is this going to happen? Verse 34, how can this be? It's okay to ask God questions. Now, that's the difference between questioning God with doubts and asking God questions. This is a legitimate question that she asked, right? How is this going to happen? I've never been with a man before. I'm a virgin. How is this going to happen? It's a legitimate question that any of us would want answers to. And I love the angel's answer, Gabriel's answer, verse 35, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the highest will overshadow you. I'm so grateful that in our weaknesses that his strength is made perfect. That his spirit at times when we are weak, when we feel like we can't go on, when we feel like we can't go further, that his strength, that his spirit will overshadow us if we take a step. I like to say it like God gives, you know, supernatural. God does supernatural things, but there's no supernatural without natural.
You're right.
You got to step out into some things. And as you're stepping out, the super comes on the natural to give us supernatural things. Let me give a hair analogy. Those of us with the curly hair, like tightly curled. Some people call it nappy, but they call it natural. You know, so you put a little oil on there, you put some product on there to make it do certain things, right? You can put certain things on your hair. Brothers, we know about this too. You can put something on your beard, right? And you know, you can comb your beard or you can comb your hair. That product is now put on your natural, causing it to do something that it wasn't going to do at first. See, that's what God's spirit will do in your life. His power will come on your natural, his super on your natural, to cause supernatural things to happen. Paul understood this when he said, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. He says here that the highest, the power of the highest will overshadow you. Therefore, also that who's to be born will be called the Son of God. First thing I said was Mary, she did what? She listened. Yes, she probably had doubts at first. She probably didn't understand how was this going to happen. How were these things going to happen? But she listened. And there may be some things that you hear this year that will challenge you, that will push you. And you will say, I don't know how I'm going to do it. I don't know how is this going to get done. Like, I don't know how is this going to happen. But I'm listening, God. What are you listening for? You're listening for the voice of God. You're listening for the voice of God. John chapter 10, Jesus talks about his sheep and how his sheep hear his voice and the voice of another they will not follow. We've got to learn to listen for the voice of God. There's so many voices that are speaking today. If you're on social media, there's all kinds of voices that are speaking. There are voices on TV and voices in our circle of influence. There are all kinds of voices that we hear, but we've got to make sure we hear the voice of God.
Yes,
like never before. What is God telling you? What is God showing you? Now, let me give you some guidelines, because sometimes we get kind of spooky with God told me, right? We get, you know, people have been hurt behind God told me. God told me you were going to be my husband. No, he didn't tell me that. God told me to quit my job. Well, did he tell you, you know, to have another deal, go look for another one? You know, some of the stuff we blame on God is kind of spooky. So let me just give you some guidelines. When you hear from God, first of all, it's going to give you peace. God is not the author of confusion, right? But the author of peace. He's the author of peace. He's not the author of confusion. So if you hear something from God or somebody try to tell you something that's from God and it's confusing you, you go to God and say, God, this is confusing me. That's what Mary did, right? She's like, how can this be? How can this be? God, give me clarity. So ask God for confirmation. Listen, when God speaks, he speaks a number of ways. Sometimes he speaks through other people. That's why we have pastors and teachers, right? So that he can speak through us. I mean, me speak through them and other people. Sometimes God will use a total stranger. My calling into the ministry was in a food court in Nashville, Tennessee. I was at a National Baptist Student Convention in a food court in Nashville, Tennessee. And a guy that I was talking to with a friend of mine, out of the blue, he said, "Brother, I got a word for you." He said, but first he started talking to my friend. He looked at me again and said, "You've been called to the ministry. You need to accept your calling." Now, God had already been dealing with me. This wasn't something just out of the blue, because God had already been dealing with me about ministry. But to have a total stranger just rock my world and tell me something like that was like, okay, God, I'm listening now. I'm listening. I hear you. God will speak to other people. Sometimes God speaks through dreams and visions. Sometimes. Sometimes it's the spaghetti you ate the day before, the enchiladas you ate the day before. But God will speak through dreams and visions, especially if you keep having the same dream, the same vision over and over again. Sometimes God speaks through dreams and visions, but he always speaks through his word. It lines up. When we hear something, it's going to line up with the word. God is not going to tell us to go rob a bank when he said in his word, "Thou shalt not steal." Are y'all following me? See, that's why we got to line everything up with the word of God, because we may hear something that sounds off, and we come back to the word, and the word gives us correction. It guides us. So God speaks to us, we need to listen. Are we listening? And sometimes God may tell you something, and you're like, man, I don't know how that's going to happen. But again, you have peace, and you have a confidence. You have an assurance. Sometimes God has to confirm it by sending you people to confirm it. But God speaks. God doesn't just speak to the preacher. He can speak to you. And I'm not talking about no big things, you know, where you're going to go off and start a ministry, you know, and all of that kind of thing. No, it just could be about your marriage. You know, things that you need to do with your children or with your finances, with your physical body. God could be telling you not to eat so many sweets. Amen. Y'all quiet in here on that. I hear y'all. I feel y'all on that, though. You don't need that second piece of cheesecake. Come on now. My wife threw away, she had made a pound cake for Christmas, and we had a little bit left. Boy, I had kind of had some plans for it. And she said, "We're going to have to get rid of some sugar. We're going to have to get rid of some things in this house." And she threw that big piece of pound cake away. It just really just saddened my spirit. But sometimes God speaks to us about those things. And, you know, if God is always speaking to you about other people, then you need to check yourself. Because God speaks to us about ourselves more than he will about other people. God told me to tell you. No, what is he telling you? And that same Holy Spirit that gives us warm and fuzzy feelings when we're in a church service will tell us, you know you're wrong for that. You could have treated that checker a little bit better at Walmart. Instead, you want to give them a piece of your mind because they had an attitude. See, the Holy Spirit would do that. But are we listening? We have to listen. We have to listen about decisions that we must make. And the second thing I said, Mary learned. What did she learn? In verse 36, verse 35, verse 36, and verse 37, the angel gives her assurance of what's going to happen. He says that the power of the Holy Spirit is going to come on you, overshadow you, and the Holy One that is to be born will be called the Son of God. And then he says, look, your relative Elizabeth, she's pregnant. You know, Elizabeth was older. Mary was possibly a teenage girl, 14 or 15 years old, which wasn't uncommon in their day. But Elizabeth was an older woman. And it was believed that she was beyond childbearing years. But the angel says, with God, nothing is impossible. Your relative Elizabeth, she's pregnant right now. And Mary is learning. Mary is learning. The angel says to her, for with God, nothing will be impossible. Mary is learning. And if we're going to be successful in this year, we need to learn. me tell y'all this real quick. There's some things you should have learned in 2023. Some lessons that you don't need to repeat in 2024. You should have learned some things. But let me also tell you, there are some things you need to relearn. Some lessons that you learned a long time ago that you kind of put it to the side, but now it's time for you to relearn. And then there are some things, my friend, that you need to unlearn. You learn some things of how to treat your spouse that didn't work. Or maybe you learned it from somebody that it wasn't working for them, and then you try to do it. You wonder why it ain't working. Well, you need to unlearn that, right? Some bad habits. Anybody got bad habits? You don't have to raise your hand. We'll do altar call in a little bit. Some bad habits that you need to unlearn. There's some things you need to learn. There's some things you need to relearn. And there's some things you need to unlearn if you're going to be successful in this year. And then the third thing, verse 38, Mary leaned. What did she say? Verse 38, look at it if you have it. Behold, the maidservant of the Lord. Let it be according to me, according to your word. Let it be to me according to your word. She put herself in a place of power. She's leaning on the Lord. You know those things you talk about leaning on the Lord? I'm leaning on the everlasting God. I'm leaning on the Lord. She said, Lord, be it unto me according to your word. In other words, have your way in my life. The greatest position of power that you could ever be in is to say, Lord, have your way in my life. Yes, Paul said, I yield. That is the most powerful statement that you can say. Lord, I yield. Have your way in my life. I'm going to lean on you because there are some things I believe God wants to do in your life, some places God wants to take you in your life, and it's going to require you to lean on him. You can't do it in your own strength. You can't do it in your own power. I believe that we've got witnesses here today. You went through some things in 2023 and you didn't know how you were going to make it, and all you could do was say, Lord, help me. Yes. There's some prayer sometimes that you only can say. You know, you may not know the five steps of anointed prayer, the five steps of intercessory prayer. Sometimes you just can say, Lord, help me. Lord, save me. The thief on the cross, he just said, just cried out to God. When you come into your kingdom, remember me. Sometimes that's all we can say, Lord, deliver me. I keep making a mess of things. I keep fouling things up. I keep screwing things up. Lord, help me. Lord, deliver me. Am I talking to anybody today? We've got to learn to lean on him. Let it be to me, according to your word. And notice verse 38, when she said that, the angel left. Because at the end, at that point, she got it. At that point, it was all good. I believe it was at that point she conceived. I believe she probably felt something. At that point, now she's conceiving. She's ready to go. Because she listened, she learned, and she leaned. Listen, we're leaning on power. I'm talking about the power of God. Do y'all believe in the power of God? You know, it's one thing to hear about it. You know, we sing them, but you know, you can talk about the power. But do you really believe the power of God can work in your life? Do y'all really believe that? That the power of God can work. That Pastor Davis gave the challenge of discipling. Do y'all really believe that God can use you to disciple somebody? That sounds like a big word, disciple. Oh, I'm a disciple. You want me to disciple somebody? Well, I'm trying to be a disciple myself. I'm trying to learn. But do you believe that God can use you to disciple somebody? Do you believe that God can use you to reach somebody? Do you believe that God can use you to touch somebody's life? Because the same power that raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. That's what Romans says. Romans 8 tells us. Romans 8, Paul says to us, the same power that raised Jesus from the dead lives in you, in your body. Think about that for a moment. That same power that was at work when Jesus Christ was arrested by the Roman authorities, taken from judgment hall to judgment hall, the same power that sustained him as his disciples walked away from him, the same power that sustained him as they beat him upside the head, as they plucked the hair from his beard, as they whipped him with cat o' nine tails, as that same power that sustained him as they nailed him to a cross and they hung him up to die, that same power that sustained him where he could say, you don't take my life, I'm giving it. That same power that sustained him on the cross, even though he said, Father, he said, why have you forsaken me? That same power that was sustaining him into the grave and that raised him back to life. Guess what? It's in you. It's in you. Somebody say it's in me. And this is not just me making it up. Ephesians 3:20 says, now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that you ask or think, watch this, according to the power working in you. It's already. Y'all remember that old Ragu commercial? Ragu spaghetti sauce? What was the thing that said? It's in there. It's in there. Somebody say it's in there. He's in me. The same power that conceived Jesus in the womb of Mary is at work in you. Yes. That's what you've got working for you in 2024. Yes. But you got to listen. You got to what? You got to learn. And you got to lead. God bless you. God bless you. Hallelujah. God bless you. Praise God. Hallelujah. We want to give an invitation right now tonight. You see here DJ say tonight. I want you to know for sure that you have a relationship with God. That you have a relationship with God through Jesus Christ. Listen, it's a fact that a man named Jesus walked the face of the earth. People don't even argue that. Other religions acknowledge that a man named Jesus walked the face of the earth. But this wasn't just an ordinary man. He wasn't just a prophet or a great teacher, a moral leader. He was Christ, Son of God, God the Son. He came to be a bridge, to be a go-between between man and God. He is all God, but he is all man to bring man and God together again. And by confessing him as Lord of our lives, by putting our faith and our trust in what he's done for us, we're saved. That's it. No more, no less. The Bible tells us that we cannot work our way. We cannot work our way into heaven. It says it is not by works that we're saved, but by grace through faith. It is a gift by believing. Do you have a brain in your head? How many of y'all have a brain in your head? How many of y'all just raise your hand? Some of y'all didn't raise your hand. You don't know if you have a brain? It's not a trick question. You got a brain in your head. How do you know you have a brain? Have you cut open your brain? Your head and looked at, had somebody look inside your head and say, you got a brain? No, but you took the word of somebody, right, that has studied and studied human anatomy and can say there's a brain up there. And you demonstrate the traits of having a brain by being able to act and move, right? You took the word of somebody. You believe that you got a brain up there. Well, guess what? Take my word. No, don't take my word. Take God's word. That if you will believe in your heart and confess with your mouth, you shall be saved. This is an opportunity right now for you to come and give your life to him. To give your life. What an opportunity. December 31st of 2023. The last day of the year, you go into the new year with a new life, a new relationship. Anybody want that today? If that's you, why don't you meet me at the altar today? You say, I want this new life. I want this new relationship. I want to give my life to the Lord Jesus Christ. Can you meet me or Pastor Davis? We're not going to embarrass you or call you out. We want you to know for sure that you have salvation. Salvation. Hallelujah. Anybody today, you say, I want to give my life to Jesus. I want to commit myself to him. Maybe you need to rededicate. Maybe you need to rededicate. You realize you've been leaning on something else. You've been leaning on strength. You've been leaning on, I'm going to have to go there, leaning on the four J's. You know who the four J's are? Jim, Jack, Johnny, and Jose? Mary Jane? You've been leaning on something else or someone else. But now it's time to lean on God. Rededicate yourself today. This is an opportunity for you to rededicate yourself to Him. To come to the altar and rededicate yourself to the Lord. Is that anybody today? I want everybody to pray this prayer. Just pray this prayer. Repeat after me. Heavenly Father, I ask you to forgive me of my sins. I believe in my heart and I confess with my mouth that you have raised Jesus from the dead. Save me. Fill me with your spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You prayed that prayer today and you believe it. Like you got a brain in your head. You believe you got a brain in your head. You're saved. You may not have had no earthquake moment, no warm fuzzy feelings, no goosebumps. But you know that you have salvation. Now you got to live it out. You got to live it out. We're not saved by works, but when we get saved, we do some work. We do some work. Praying, evangelizing, discipling. That's part of the work. It doesn't save us, but it's what saved people do. Y'all understand what I'm saying? So now that you know that you're saved, listen. Lean. Listen, learn, and lean so that now you can go forth and show the works. God bless you. God bless you.
Oh, we thank God for the man of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah to the Lamb. God is such an awesome and amazing God. He has truly ministered to us here tonight. And as we look at the fleeing moments from 2023, we'll do two final things. The Bible said after they took communion, they walked out. The Bible says they sung a hymn and they walked out. So as we do our custom for this time of year, we want everybody to stand and get in the group with your family. With your family. If you don't have a family, attach yourself with somebody tonight because we're all family. I want everybody to stand, get in the group with your family. Find your family all over this room, and if your family is not here, attach yourself to somebody. We don't want anybody alone. We don't want anybody by themselves. Attach yourself to somebody. Amen. I'll ask Pastor to come back and lead us in our family prayer for 2024, and then we will proceed to communion.
Father God, tonight we come on behalf of families, every family that's represented here in this household, and even those that may be watching online. We pray a special blessing upon each family, each household. We know your heart for families, God.
Thank you.
God, that you established even in the beginning, family, before all the other things, God, family was first and foremost. And so we know that you have a special place for families. Bless these families, these marriages, God. We thank you for strengthening the marriages, God, that are represented here today. Thank you, God, that they will continue to grow closer to you and each other. God, that you will give them peace. God, in this year, God, we thank you for giving the desires of their heart as they delight themselves in you.
Yes.
Thank you for meeting every need, God, that they will not lack for anything. God, because this is your will to take care of your children. God, we thank you, Lord, that each family will represent you and be lights that shine in darkness, that when people see the family, God, that they will see your love, that they will know unconditional love, God, because of the family that demonstrates your love. Thank you, God, for keeping our children, watch over them, our grown children, our small children, our grandchildren, godchildren, nieces and nephews, extended family. Thank you for the grandparents and the wisdom, God, that is in them. And we thank you, God, that they will share that wisdom, God, with their family, God, and impart legacy and wisdom and truth, God, and that they will see the fruit of their labor. Thank you, God, that we speak revival in every household.
Yes, Lord.
Every household that's represented today, God, that revival will take place so that others will come and want to know more about you. Be glorified in each household. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Also, I want to pray for those loved ones that are fallen into addiction. Anybody got a loved one that's struggling with an addiction, drug addiction, gambling, alcohol? Anybody got a family member? I want to pray specifically for them, for those that have drifted and gotten caught up in that addiction. Father, we just lift them right now to you. We pray that 2024 will be the year that they will truly walk in freedom. God, because your word says, whom the Son sets free is free indeed. We declare freedom over their life, God. God, keep your hand upon them, God, wherever they may be, God. God, that they will be able to break free of the stronghold of the enemy, God. God, thank you that you will set them free, that you will put the right people around them, God, that will help them to see the light, God, that truth will penetrate their hearts, God, and their eyes will be open to the truth, God, so that they can be delivered and set free in Jesus' name.
we stand up and we're going to celebrate two things. We're going to celebrate the brand new year of 2024. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're going to celebrate what Jesus has done for us.
Happy New Year, baby.